Thank you for that kind introduction, Dr. Kennedy. As he said, I'll be talking about surgical quality, a systems-based approach. I have no financial disclosures. However, as you may have guessed, surgical quality is a broad topic, so I will disclose that I have biased my examples and I'll give, and they will be primarily colorectal in nature. But I certainly hope you can apply them to your own subspecialties as far as the concepts are concerned. To give you an overview, we'll first talk about the definition of quality, then we'll talk about surgical quality. We'll give you a historical perspective. We need to talk about how to measure surgical quality. We'll talk about the systems involved in surgical quality and the implications. Quality is a difficult thing to define, even for Webster's Dictionary. They describe it as a degree of excellence, superiority in kind, a distinguishing attribute, an acquired skill, the character and a logical proposition of being affirmative or negative, peculiar or essential character. So what is surgical quality? In an attempt to answer this question, we must first look at a historical perspective on surgical quality. In 1899, when Dr. Miles was appointed to the Royal College of Surgeons, the standard was a two-stage approach to rectal cancer. You first had a diverting loop sigmoid colostomy, then 2 weeks later, you had rectal resection via the perineum. There was a 21% mortality rate and 95% recurrence rate between 6 months and 3 years. So at this point, Dr. Miles asked himself, is this surgical quality? To have a nearly 100% of my patients die of their cancer shortly after the time of their surgery. Is it enough to give patients more time, or can we cure cancer? This led him to describe the lateral, downward, and upward cancerous spread. Downward, meaning to the perineal skin, issue rectal fat, and external sphincter muscles. Lateral spread, meaning to the levator ani muscles, the retrorectal lymph nodes, the interiliac lymph node channels, the prostate gland, the base of the bladder, the posterior wall of the vagina and cervix, and the broad ligament. And upward spread, meaning to the peritoneum of the floor of the pelvis, the pelvic mesocolon, pericolic lymph nodes, and the lymph nodes at the bifurcation of the left common iliac artery. This led him to describe the en bloc removal of rectal cancer together with lymph nodes in a combined abdominal perineal approach, what we know today as the APR. His operation took 50 minutes in the operating room. He had a 29.5% recurrence rate and 31% mortality rate. So surgical quality was curing 2/3 of his patients of their cancers at the expense of a 10% increase in mortality. Even with our historical perspective, I think we'll have a hard time defining surgical quality, but it will be our goal by the end of the talk. So instead, why don't we think about the ideal characteristics of surgical quality? Ideally, it would be reproducible, objectively measurable, cost-effective, independent of or adjustable for patient variables, teachable, transferable between subspecialties, between hospitals, and between surgeons, and perhaps more. If those are our ideal characteristics, then how do we measure quality? Birkmeyer et al. Described 3 ways to measure quality. Structural measures, the setting or system in which care is delivered, process measures, care patients actually receive, and direct outcomes measures, or the end result of surgery. Structural measures are the setting or system in which care is delivered. Examples of this include procedure volume, fellowship-trained surgeons, or closed intensive care units. Process measures, or the care patients actually receive, would be perioperative beta blockade in high-risk surgical patients, or the use of internal mammary graft during coronary artery bypass grafting, or more familiar to us, DVT prophylaxis, or antibiotic wound prophylaxis. Examples of outcomes measures for surgical quality are the things we're most familiar with: morbidity and mortality rates, or functional health status, patient satisfaction, or even cost. Each of these measures has primary advantages and disadvantages. The primary advantage for structural measures is that they are expedient, inexpensive proxies for surgical outcomes. The primary advantage for process measures is that they reflect the care that patients actually receive, and physicians believe that they're more fair as a use for quality measure. And in fact, physicians and providers can actually change their actions as a reflection of what that process measure is showing them. Outcomes as a process, quality measure has the most buy-in from surgeons. It's the bottom line of what we do. However, outcomes measurements alone may very well improve outcomes. The disadvantage of using structural measures is that most variables are not actionable by the provider. If you're at a low volume hospital, it's highly difficult to change that particular structural measure. They're also imperfect proxies for outcomes, and they reflect the average for a large group, not individual providers. Limitation of process measures as a way to measure quality is that there's little information about which processes are important for which specific procedures. And using outcomes as a quality measure is difficult only when the numbers are too small to measure with adequate precision for procedure-specific outcomes for certain hospitals or certain procedures. The outcomes measures that are not procedure-specific are far less useful for quality improvement. The two things that are most important when applying these measures is the baseline risk for the operation and the caseload per hospital. How commonly it is performed. This figure has an example of a variety of operations. Low risk and high common operations include hernia repair, cholecystectomy, and thyroidectomies. High risk but low hospital volume operations include esophagectomy or pancreatic resections. And the colectomies are moderate risk at a relatively high volume of operations per hospital. But to continue our discussion, we need to add one to our list to be consistent with my disclaimers at the beginning. We need to add proctectomy, which is a little more risky than a colectomy and a little less common, so it probably falls about here. So let's start with procedures that have low baseline risk and low caseloads per hospital. The recommendation for this is focus on other procedures. That's right. The amount of effort, time, and money that goes into quality improvement is not worth it for rare operations with very low risk. Now let's move to the most intuitive quality measure, outcomes. These are best applied to high-risk operations with high case volumes. Let's look at proctectomy and see how an outcomes measure has changed that how that operation has been done. The total mesorectal excision was introduced in 1982. It is a complete and anatomic removal of the lymphovascular pedicle. Heald describes, with sharp dissection under direct vision, the pelvic fascia and autonomic nerve plexus were preserved by pursuing a lipoma-like outer surface. The total mesorectal excision significantly improved disease-free and overall survival. This table compares the North Central Cancer Treatment Group data to total mesorectal excision. TME had a local recurrence rate of 5% as compared to conventional surgery, either with radiation or with chemo and radiation, had local recurrence rates at 25% and 13.5%. The overall recurrence rate of TME was 22%, as opposed to conventional surgery at 62% and 41%. Shortly thereafter, the Dutch trial compared the total mesorectal excision to total mesorectal excision with neoadjuvant radiotherapy. There was no difference in overall survival, but even at just 2 years, there was a significant difference in local recurrence, with surgery alone having a local recurrence at 8.2% and surgery with radiation having a recurrence of 2.4%. So the standard of care, or surgical quality, for rectal cancer is now total mesorectal excision with neoadjuvant chemoradiation. But this is not objectionably measurable characteristics. Pathology reports do not include a checkbox for total versus near total mesorectal excisions. What's interesting is that in Europe, West and colleagues are now studying the complete mesocolic excision with central vascular ligation. This is based on their 2008 retrospective observational data showing that intact mesocolon has a 15% better overall survival. Nevertheless, this is an attempt at improving the quality of resection for colon cancer, which may or may not see the same benefits of rectal cancer, as a circumferential margin and local recurrence is less critical in colon cancer. Now let's look at low-risk operations with high caseloads. Using mortality as a quality measure for hernia repair is problematic because the mortality rate is so low. In order to detect a statistically significant doubling of the baseline mortality risk for cases with 1% baseline mortality, you need 979 cases. That's a lot of hernias. Even for Dr. Greenberg, who has managed to fix 7 patients' hernia in a week's time span, only gets to 336 for the entire year. So for the low-risk operations with high caseloads, Birkmeier et al. Recommend focusing on process measures. As you recall, process measures are the care patients actually receive. And one of the primary advantages of process measures is they are easy to measure, and providers can change what they do to impact them. In fact, primary care physicians already are graded on the proportion of appropriate patients in their practice that are receiving mammography or pneumococcal vaccine. For surgery, the process measures have focused on surgical site infections. Even for process measures to be applied appropriately, they must be used as a even process measures need to be applied appropriately, and they must be used so that they can measure both hospital and surgeon quality. Coe et al. Looked at 181 ACS NISQIP hospitals who did 18,455 colectomies with an overall surgical site infection rate of 10.5%. The proportion of variation explained by patient factors was consistent across the hospital caseloads. But to achieve a 70% reliability of using surgical site infection as a quality measure, a minimum of 94 cases had to be reported. That meant for the 181 hospitals in this study, only 54% of the hospitals had enough cases for surgical site infection to be a reliable quality measure. Surgical Care Improvement Project, or SCIP, is another example of applying a process measure to surgery. SCIP was implemented after the 2002 project, which collected data on appropriate timing, selection, and discontinuation of prophylactic antibiotics decreased surgical site infection rates in 56 hospitals. SCIP then began in 2006 with the goal to reduce complications by 25% in 2010. What you may not realize is that SCIP measures are for specific operations. It is for CABGs and cardiac surgery, hip and knee arthroplasty, colon surgery, hysterectomy, and arterial vascular surgery. Colon surgery is included in 5 of the 6 measures. We are measured on prophylactic antibiotic given within 60 minutes, appropriate antibiotic selection, discontinuation of prophylactic antibiotics within 24 hours, appropriate hair removal, and normothermia. Cardiac surgery is also measured on postoperative glucose control. For those of you paying attention to details, you'll see that SCIP measure number 5 isn't listed. However, it is simply the postoperative wound infection diagnosed within the index hospitalization. Hahn and colleagues looked at the VA data from 2005, just before SCIP implementation, to 2009. They looked at 112 VA hospitals who did just over 60,000 surgeries. The surgical site infection rate for colorectal surgeries was 11.3%. For orthopedic surgeries, it was 1.6%. And the overall average for all of the operations included in their study was 6.2%. Their adherence for skip measures ranged from 75 to 99%. After adjusting for patient and procedure factors, including age, work RVUs, operative time, specialty, diabetes, COPD, steroid use, ASA class, wound class, smoking status, dyspnea, alcohol abuse, history of radiation therapy, and gender, the adherence to skip rates increased. However, the surgical site infection rate remained stable. Now, for high-risk, low-case volume operations, these are best measured by structural measures, the setting or system in which care is delivered. So let's look again at proctectomy. Porter and colleagues looked at 683 patients who had an LAR or APR by 52 surgeons, five of which were colorectal trained, from 1983 to 1990 in five different Canadian hospitals. Their five-year local recurrence rate was 33.2%, and disease-specific survival was 59%. The bold line represents colorectal trained surgeons who had at least 21 to 50 resections. The thin line represents colorectal trained surgeons or surgeons who had 21 to 50 resections. And the dotted line were surgeons who were neither colorectal trained nor had zero and only had 0 to 20 resections. In both Kaplan-Meier curves, for local recurrence and for disease-specific survival, the patients who had their operations done by high-volume colorectal surgeons had the best outcomes. So we've discussed examples of each of these quality measures, but they are not standalone. Birkmeier notes that you can link outcomes and process measures. Luckily, our very own Sarah Tevis has been looking at just that. She studied 355 patients that had proctectomy from 1995 to 2012. And looked at the overall complication rate, which was 30%. The complications she included were surgical site infection, wound dehiscence, pneumonia, reintubation, pulmonary embolism, respiratory failure, acute renal failure, UTI, stroke, coma, neurologic deficit, cardiac arrest, myocardial infarction, postoperative bleeding requiring transfusion, DVT, and sepsis. If a patient has a complication, they trend toward decreased overall survival. This is an outcomes measure. Now, if they have a delay more than 8 weeks in receiving their adjuvant chemotherapy, they have significant decrease in their overall survival. This is a process measure. Timing of chemotherapy is something that we can change about the care of a patient. It's easily measured and modifiable by physicians. What most of this table says is there is no significant difference in patient characteristics who have adjuvant chemotherapy greater or less than 8 weeks postoperatively with regard to their age, gender, comorbidities, stage at diagnosis, indication for chemotherapy, type of operation, if they had radiation, and their discharge disposition. However, I'll highlight this area of the table, and you'll see that postoperative complications and readmissions within 30 days are associated with delays of chemotherapy greater than 8 weeks. Finally, Tevis looked at the timing of chemotherapy in patients with postoperative complications and those without postoperative complications. This data shows that the risk of death was significantly greater for patients with complications who received adjuvant chemotherapy greater than 8 weeks after their surgery. In patients without complications, there is also a trend toward worse overall survival for patients receiving chemotherapy at greater than 8 weeks. This has to redirect our thinking about surgical quality even more. We have to think about systems involved in surgical quality. Who decides the timing of postoperative chemotherapy? Who implements this process measure of quality for a surgical patient? If quality is measured by process measures or outcomes, are all hospital systems created equal? 11 medical oncology centers in Florida studied 507 of their patients with colorectal cancers. They identified 35 quality indicators. The quality indicators were identified by a panel of medical and surgical oncology experts at Moffitt Cancer Center in Tampa, Florida, using the American Society of Clinical Oncology, the National Comprehensive Cancer Care Network, the National Initiative for Cancer Care Quality, Quality Oncology Practice Initiative, National Quality Forum, and the American College of Surgeons. 16 of their 35 indicators had less than 85% adherence. They divided these indicators into three groups. Quality indicators 30 to 35 related to radiation oncology. The quality indicators below 85% adherence are in bold. So we ask ourselves, what factors on this page can surgeons directly contribute to? Well, we can refer our patients for consultation with a radiation oncologist. Quality indicators 19 through 29 are related to medical oncology. Again, what factors can surgeons directly contribute to? We certainly can have our patients considered for adjuvant chemotherapy. We can also help make sure that our patients get their chemotherapy within 8 weeks of their resection. And finally, if the patient happens to see the surgery first, we can refer them to a medical oncologist if they're appropriate for neoadjuvant therapy so that they get their neoadjuvant therapy within 8 weeks. Quality indicators 1 through 18 relate to surgery and pathology. The factors surgeons can directly contribute to here, we can certainly make sure our patients get a barium enema or colonoscopy within 6 months prior to their resection. We can make sure they get a serum CEA before they have resection for colorectal cancers. But numbers 4 through 15 are all directly related to our pathology reports. Should we page our pathologists if we don't see evidence on the pathology report in regards to lymphovascular invasion or perineural invasion or with the status of their radial margin? Or how about if there's at least 12 lymph nodes? This brings up another process measure that has been used for surgical quality, the presence or minimum of at least 12 lymph nodes. However, there is no definitive evidence that the surgeon or pathologist can influence the yield of lymph nodes. In fact, most of the related factors are due to the patient. For every decade older a patient happens to be, there's a 9% decrease in lymph node yield. If they have an increased BMI, they have decreased lymph node yield. If the tumor size increases by 1 centimeter, they increase the lymph node yield by 2 to 3%. If the tumor is from the ascending or hepatic flexure resection, they have 34% lymph nodes that compared to a sigmoidectomy. And neoadjuvant therapy reduces the lymph node yield. So at this point, the College of American Pathologists recommends re-examining the specimen if there's not, in fact, 12 found at the initial examination and nothing more. If this lymph node benchmark is primarily related to patient factors, is it fair that in 2001, the National Cancer Institute made a minimum of 12 lymph nodes a quality surveillance measure? Villaroma and colleagues studied just over 1,200 hospitals who performed just over 150,000 colectomies. He looked at the time periods just before and just after the implementation of the National Cancer Institute recommendation. The overall compliance at the two time periods for lymph node evaluation increased from 15% to 38.9%. However, he then broke it down based on hospital type. National Comprehensive Cancer Centers had the biggest change in lymph node compliance from 15.6% up to 78.1%. This was more than the other types of hospitals evaluated. Other academic centers at 52%, VA centers at 53%, and community hospitals at 33%. This data shows a link between a process measure and a structural measure for surgical quality. Timing of chemotherapy is a process measure that links outcomes to process measures for proctectomy patients. Pathology specimens with greater than 12 lymph nodes is a process measure that links to hospital type as a structural measure for quality measures for surgical patients. Both of these links occur because the system of surgical quality encompasses more than just the surgeon. So is there a link between structural measures and outcomes? Jafari et al. Looked at the ACS NISQIP data from 2005 to 2007. It restricted it to the inpatients undergoing procedures with mortality rates of greater than 1%. This gave him a study population of 84,730 patients. This cohort was 23% of the database, but 68% of the deaths. They then looked at all complications, the rate of major complications, and the rate of death in each of these groups based on the hospital's mortality rates. All complications included wound infections, acute renal failure, postoperative bleeding requiring a transfusion, myocardial infarction, pneumonia, stroke, intubation, fascial dehiscence, prolonged ventilation, DVT, UTI, septic shock, vascular graft loss, renal insufficiency. Major complications simply excluded UTIs, DVTs without PE, superficial wound infections, and renal insufficiency not requiring hemodialysis. What they found is that there's no significant difference of the overall complication rate or the major complication rate, regardless of what the hospital mortality is. However, the very high hospital mortalities had a mortality rate of 21%, compared to the very low mortality hospitals at 12.5%. They call this phenomenon failure to rescue. But why? What makes certain hospitals capable of recovering patients from major complications while others cannot? To answer this question, they looked at 8,862 patients undergoing pancreatectomy in 672 hospitals from nationwide inpatient sampling using the ICD-9 codes for the previous M&Ms listed. In pancreatectomy patients, there was actually a higher odds ratio of having a major complication at 2.3 for the very high compared to the very low mortality hospitals. However, the mortality rate odds ratio was 16.5. with raw data of very high mortality hospitals having a mortality of 19.1% compared to very low mortality hospitals at 1.5%. They then evaluated and compared the very high mortality hospitals to the very low mortality hospitals as far as their characteristics. They found that very low mortality hospitals tended to be hospitals with high hospital technology. They tended to be teaching hospitals. They tended to have a low incidence of high increased to nurse practitioner ratio, nurse to patient ratios. They tended to be larger hospitals with greater than 200 beds. And they tended to have an average daily census of at least 50% of their capacity. They then broke it down based on the proportion of each of these characteristics that could be attributed to failure to rescue. And the majority, they found, of the time, that failure to rescue was because of a lack of high hospital technology or it being a non-teaching hospital. So what are the implications? The implication is we have moved from a surgeon-centric quality to a systems-based quality with multidisciplinary aspects for our surgical patients. When this system of quality care for our surgical patients, complications will happen. We as surgeons can change our attitudes or our actions toward the process, structural, and outcomes measures toward that complication in hopes that there is a certain amount of complications that we can, if we focus our efforts on quality, we can impact. So we come back to our goal for a definition of surgical quality. I think the definition is more of a concept or a mindset, one that has actually been passed down in this department for many attendings from the time of Dr. Belzer. I think surgical quality means to do the right thing, and we should push ourselves to do the right thing, right, every time. And I'm happy to take any questions.